Hey, welcome to another episode of MLM Renegade. Today I'm excited to talk with Shannon Lewis, who has a marketing agency that focuses on personal branding. Check it out. So here's the million-dollar question. How are network marketers like us, who've tried everything their upline ever suggested to be successful, and yet still struggled, who grew up with technology and aren't stuck in the 20th century, how are we supposed to grow our downlines and our bank accounts and yet still have time for real life? My name is J.R. McKee. Join me as we explore how to use 21st century learning and technology to grow our downlines and build lasting wealth. Simply put, this is MLM done different. Welcome to MLM Renegade. So I did this awesome interview with Shannon Lewis from 36.Marketing, and I want to share it with you guys here. But we talked a lot about personal branding and being really authentic, especially when it comes to in your MLM and in social media, because that's why people follow you. So I want to share this with you, but I'm really excited. Please go check out her page at the end of the interview. We talk about how to get a hold of her. But she's amazing, and this is this was a lot of fun. Okay, thanks for joining us this morning. This morning I'm really excited. We've got an interview here with Shannon Lewis, and Shannon runs 36.Marketing out of Orlando, Florida, isn't it, Shannon?
It's kind of all over. It's a remote agency, believe it or not. So I'm based out of Tampa, but I'm in Orlando quite a lot.
Okay, fantastic. So, Shannon, today we want to talk about personal branding. We know that especially in network marketing, that personal branding is so important as people are utilizing the web and utilizing social media, especially to both influence other people, sell their products, as well as find new business partners. Personal branding has become such an issue, and I think it's something that is so poorly taught within the industry. But before we kind of dive into that, I'd love to get a little bit of your background, kind of how you came to form 36, kind of where you're coming from, and even a little bit of kind of how you got involved in network marketing as well.
Yeah, absolutely. So I've been doing marketing now for about 15 years. I started at the corporate level working for Fortune 500 companies and then moved to the agency sectors. I finally just got to a point where I wanted more flexibility with my life. I wanted to be able to travel. I wanted to be able to be at family events. I wanted to be able to go to every single friend event that I had going on, weddings and things of that nature. And so I just decided to open up my own agency. And instead of doing the typical brick and mortar, cool, trendy office with the ping pong table, I decided to reinvest that money and work with the best of the best in the industries. So I reinvested it in all my employees and all of the contractors that I work with. So I kind of look at it as revolutionizing the way how marketing is done, because you don't necessarily need to all be in the same office or location to have that common goal and to get everything done. So that's kind of how 36 was born. Been doing that now for about 4 years, which is great. I love it. I love every aspect of helping businesses grow and helping brands grow. And it was just about a year ago, I got involved in network marketing as well. And primary reason there is, Warren Buffett always says, any successful entrepreneur is going to have multiple income streams.
There you go. It's very difficult to argue with Warren.
Yes.
the guy is, that was, no, very, very enlightening. I appreciate that. I need to shut down some audio here on my computer, apparently. So when you got involved with network marketing, tell me a little bit about how that came about. You told me a little bit about the story, but I'd love to hear kind of your view on the industry before and maybe a little bit after.
I always laugh because before I did my own research and before I got involved in network marketing, I was against it at all costs. I looked at it as just like as a setup of failure, to be perfectly honest with you, to the point in all of my social media profiles, I had no network marketing companies, don't talk to me, don't reach out to me. If you're trying to sell me anything, I don't want to know anything about it. And I put it out there literally like that. And it kind of got introduced to me. I saw a lot of friends doing it, and I saw a lot of friends having success with it in terms of being able to leave their full-time jobs that were kind of constraining them from being able to enjoy their life. And to the point, one of my very good friends made the comment, she was a school teacher, of how she was constantly missing her son's activities because she had to be at school for other kids' activities, to the point that he says, well, Mom, when are you going to be there for my activities? Ouch. And so when I hear stories like that, I'm just like, you know, we have to start thinking smarter instead of working harder. And we have to start thinking about outside the box a little bit more of how we can actually generate revenue, do something we love while still living our lives. I think that's the biggest goal with our generations coming into the funnel of how can we do things smarter and better, not just the way things have always been done. Yep. So I kind of started doing my research into some of the companies that I was interested in. And yeah, I mean, that's kind of how I initially took the jump in, was I just wanted to try some of the products. Mm-hmm. I just wanted to, you know, get my hands on some products, try them out a little bit. I ended up falling in love with the products to the point where once you love something, it's just like a restaurant and saying, hey, JR, I love this restaurant. You should really try this restaurant.
Yep.
Kind of the same concept.
Absolutely. You know, it's so funny because so many people, network marketing happens every single day, and not just with network marketing companies. I mean, you talk about restaurants, like that is network marketing. Like literally you're talking to your network and you're doing some marketing for them. Yep. And you know, that's amazing.
For free.
Yeah, for free. And they didn't pay you, and maybe they should have. And, but no, that's awesome. So when it comes to personal branding, you know, I know that you've recently, especially, you've kind of taken a shine or taken an interest in helping entrepreneurs and really even more specifically inside of network marketing with that marketing coaching and that personal branding coaching. So if somebody was coming to you right off the bat, you know, and they say, okay, I need to build my personal brand. Mm-hmm. What are some of those go-to moves that you're going to go to immediately to get somebody started off on the right foot? Because so many people that are in network marketing or are just starting network marketing have never even thought about, okay, how do I make myself look better? You know, in a lot of ways, so many people are teaching what I think is a problem, where it's like sell.
Right.
And they've forgotten the marketing portion of sales, which is a whole lot more attraction and a whole lot less shoving it down somebody's throat. So again, sorry to ramble on, but what are some of those initial starting steps that you would recommend for somebody?
Yeah. I mean, I couldn't agree more with that. You know, when you go to some people's social media profiles and it's just flooded with products that they're selling, it's just instantly a turn off to a lot of people. And it honestly, in my opinion, gives it the whole industry a really bad name, because to me, it looks like you don't want to connect with me on a personal level. You're just trying to sell me something. And I think the biggest thing when we talk about building your personal brand and quote unquote selling, it's all about building relationships. This generation that's coming in, you know, the millennial, the Gen X generations, they want that human to human interaction. People want to work with people again. We don't want to work with robots. Mm-hmm. So the first thing that I always, always do with anybody, and I do this for not only my team and my downlines, but I open it to other, you know, network marketers as well who are just getting in the industry, because what a lot of people don't understand is this is your business. You are officially a business owner. People sometimes look at it as, well, I'm just paying a small investment to get into this company and now everything's going to happen for me, not realizing that they're going to have to still invest time. They're still going to have to invest some money to be able to grow that business and make it profitable for them. So the first thing that we always do is talk about your why. I think you actually talked about on one of your previous podcasts, the Simon Sinek on finding your why. It's one of my favorite TED Talks that I've seen. It's so great of understanding, why am I waking up every morning to do this? Why am I, you know, taking these extra hours out of my day when I could be, you know, just sitting watching Netflix to build something bigger than what I currently have. That's always my first thing that I do, is I ask somebody their why. And the second thing that I always do is, what's going to differentiate you from me? Because obviously we're both selling the same product. So at the end of the day, we could technically be considered competitors, but there's going to be a reason somebody's going to want to buy from me versus you, whether that's because I have that common interest of yoga, or I have that common interest of traveling. I have that common interest of I've got children. You always find those things that are going to make you relatable and that are going to make you stand out among a crowd of other people that are essentially doing the similar thing. So those are the first two things that I always do. We always establish the why, and we always establish maybe three or four things that is going to make you stand out from anybody else that's within that same industry.
That's awesome. You know, I've been doing a lot of learning and a lot of research lately. And one of my mentors, a guy named Steven Larson, and Steven is, he's probably the king of what I'll call offer creation. And a lot of that is exactly around that, that very thought. You know, it is it's an opportunity to create an offer that differentiates you, because within network marketing, you're right, we all sell the same stuff. Mm-hmm. You know, if there's a million distributors in your company, guess what? You have a million competitors. Good yep. luck.
Good
and
luck.
If you're selling exactly the same thing in exactly the same way, you're not differentiating yourself. And so now, getting past just the kind of differentiation of your personal branding, you know, I'd love to hear some of your thoughts on things that people should be doing, apart from obviously, you know, finding your why and figuring out what makes you unique, but things that you should be doing as a part of that branding effort. Like what are some of those must do's on, it's probably on social media is probably what I'm thinking about most, but what are some of those must do's that you've got in mind?
One of the biggest things that I always say is building your network. I mean, there's two big things. If you're talking in terms of social media, the word is right there, being social. You want to socialize with your followers and you want to engage with them. The second piece of attraction marketing is, again, that very first word, attraction. You know, think of it in terms of dating. You want to give just a little bit on your first date. You don't want to talk about your family's health history and how your father has heart disease and how your mother is a little bit crazy and a little bit loony. And you know, you don't want to be talking about all these things up front. You want to give just a little bit to make somebody curious about you, to want to come back and learn more and take you on that second date. And then on that third date, and then on that fourth date. And then before you know it, you're in a relationship. Right? Yep. So those are the two big words that you always want to keep in mind when you're dealing with social media, is being social, putting yourself out there, and giving just that little bit of pieces of you that's going to attract people to want to follow you and want to engage with you on that type of level. You know, funny enough, you and I met through social media.
Yep.
So, and we've been able to build a great collaborative relationship. You know, we've been able to compare ideas. And so this is kind of how social media, in my eyes, is set up. Some people will look at it as a really bad thing because it tears people away. I look at it as a great opportunity to be able to connect with other like-minded individuals.
Yep.
So in terms of what you should be doing on a regular basis is finding those people that you feel you're going to have a common interest in. And I always have a three-piece rule when I'm looking at anyone's profile in terms of, do I want to connect with them? And that's, are they relatable? Do I think that I would get along with them? And do I think they have what it takes to be successful in what I do?
Awesome. No, that's fantastic. You know, it's funny. And I think it was our last episode, you know, I introduced the Renegade Daily, a daily method of operation, and talked about, and one of the posts there, or one of the things to do, one is to interact with your network and to grow your network, right? So, you know, I've got, you know, make 10 new friends a day. Well, you know, when I go back to thinking about when Heather and I first started in network, you know, in this business here a couple of years ago, I had 850 friends on Facebook. Mm-hmm. And I went nuts. Like, I added people all over the place to where it was like 8 weeks later, I had 2,000 friends on Facebook. Mm-hmm. And now all of a sudden, I could basically re-release the same offer that I had made 2 months ago. Mm-hmm. And 75% of the people who are on my friends list hadn't seen it yet.
Right.
I mean, and so, and that's that growing that list and constantly, frankly, refreshing that list. I go through regularly as I'm going through Facebook. And if I see, you know, Debbie Downer pops up on my Facebook feed and is, and I go through her, you know, I'll give people a pass. Like, okay, you got a bad day. You want to vent a little bit? Fine. Mm-hmm. Right. People are human. But if I go through and that's all they're doing is venting, sorry, we were friends, you yes. know, and goodbye, you know, and I don't need that kind of negativity in my life. Yes. And so that's the, and that's a big part of it. As you're doing personal branding, like put out there what you want people to see about you. One of the problems with social media, Instagram especially, is that you only see the really, really, really cool stuff that happens.
Right. Right.
Where, exactly. Like regular life, like, okay, you know, let's like my children are all grown up a little bit more now, or, you know, our youngest is 9, but when we had babies, like we post cute pictures of babies and, oh, here's their 3 month picture and their 6 month picture. Right. But the pictures I enjoy the most are the ones where you see spit up all over my suit coat and a blown out diaper up the back of the kid. Like that's real. Like, and people connect with that because they're like, oh, here's this perfect child. I mean, the pictures I've seen lately, I saw one that was absolutely adorable. It was some, you know, she must've been a week old baby wrapped up like in a, I mean, she looked like a burrito with a bow on her head, basically. Mm-hmm. Like, I mean, she's wrapped up in a cocoon and they took these beautiful pictures of her. But I'm like, but you know, I remember getting with our youngest, I remember getting family pictures and he was 6 days old and we were doing these pictures and my wife wanted to have him, you know, naked on this like bearskin rug thing or this furry rug. And so we did that and he totally peed all over it.
I feel like I know where this story is going.
I mean, he told all over it. And and you know what? We just laughed. It's like, because honestly, you know, one, at that point, we were so sleep deprived, probably.
Authentic side.
It becomes an issue of either laughing.
Vulnerable pieces of you as a human being, because that's what makes you human at the end of the day. And I will say, I get more engagements on some of the posts that I do on social media where I'm showing a little bit more emotion. You know, there was a post that I did a couple of weeks ago on my Instagram page where I literally, it was one of those days where everything kind of built up. And I just had a big breakdown. And I was like, you know what? I'm going to capture this because this is the part of entrepreneurship that people don't see. Everyone always goes around saying how great it is. And here I am sitting on my yacht and here I am traveling the world. And what people don't realize is that first year to 2 to 3 to 4 years, it is nothing but hustle and grind. And if you are able to even take a trip, you are extremely lucky. So, yeah. You know, I love trying to show that side. And I think it's really important too, because again, that's what makes you human. One of my biggest pet peeves is following different bloggers and stuff. And every picture they've got is just this perfectly posed picture and you just kind of look at it like nobody holds your coffee cup like that crossing the street, you know. It's like I'm just kind of like, oh my god, like it's getting all over me. But yeah, yes. I think the more real and the more authentic you can be on social media is gonna be a part of that attraction to your following.
Yeah, I think that vulnerability it lends authenticity. It also lends people can trust you more when you're being authentic. You know, one of the things I've tried to do with this podcast is to kind of show the journey. Mm-hmm. Because that's what makes it real. Because it's really hard to follow somebody when you see that, you know, when you see a network marketing leader who's making millions of dollars a year, you know, they're doing 6 figures monthly and you're just starting out. It's cool to say, wow, I could do that. But then the back of your mind says, there is no way on earth you're going to be able to do that. And so it's this fight constantly inside your head. And the the challenge or the benefit of showing your climb to that pinnacle is so much more real for people. But then it also shows them, hey, look, I did this. Mm-hmm. Like, and not just I did this, yay for me. It's look at how I did this, because you can too. Yes. And if you're willing to put in that work and that grind and that hustle that you talked about, I mean, there's a, you know, I read a book by Richard Blissbrook, it was the 4-year career, and kind of a spin on words of the 4-hour work week, but the 4-year career basically,
4-hour work week. Great book.
Oh, fantastic book. Book. And but the 4-year career basically talked about how, look, you can work this like a career for 4 years and be in a place financially where you never have to work again.
Right.
And I mean, and people think about that, they're like, wow, 4 years isn't very long when they think about 40 years in a career. Mm-hmm. But when you're in the middle of those 4 years, it stretches on for eternity, it feels like sometimes. And the struggle is so real. But that same struggle, when you're talking about personal branding, is what makes you a real person, what makes you followable. Mm-hmm. And I think that when we're willing to get real with ourselves and to show the outside world our real self, we get a lot more credibility and people are more willing to listen to what we have to say because they know that we're not just full of crap and that we're not blowing smoke 24/7. I mean, the Instagram, you know, the Instagram influencers, we'll call them, that, you know, go out there and every pose is perfectly posed. And, you know, there, I saw a meme once about an Instagram shot of a pretty girl and how, you know, it was like, and these are all the pictures that it took to actually get this picture. It was like 25 pictures that the husband had to sit there and snap in order to get just the right pose with just the right light with my hair in the right spot. And I mean, it was hilarious to see it. And I had a lot of fun because I know some people like that.
You know, it's funny that you say that because that's kind of what we do. You know, me and my team, we are constantly doing shoots with each other because you want to have content, you want to have relevant content, you want to show real life. But what people don't understand is you literally do take 200 pictures to get that one shot where mm-hmm. everything is lined up right. You know, the sun is hitting you in the right spot. The hair is looking good. The nails are looking good. The makeup's looking good. Everything's looking good. And we always joke because we have a lot of boyfriends and husbands that will come out. And so we always call them the Instagram boyfriend or the Instagram husband, yep. where we have that joke where it's like, I'm going to need you to climb on that light post up there and hang upside down.
To block out this shadow. And yeah.
This shadow over here. But, you know, the funny part really when it comes to, and I try and educate people on this too, when it comes to those, I actually have a whole video reel that I'm putting together right now. I have yet to publish it. I will be publishing it. So as soon as I do, I'll let you know. But it's kind of the start to finish of what a photo shoot looks like and what I actually look like in real life. You know, because what I put out there, of course, that image is going to be touched up. Of course, I'm going to have that filter on it because that's what makes my page look aesthetically pleasing to the naked eye. When you're looking at it, you want to have that same filter overlay that either makes it a little bit more mute or it makes it a little bit more white or it has that pink undertone to it or that blue undertone to it, whatever it is. You know, when you see a professional influencer's page, you're going to see all of these things. You're going to see, I have like video of the photographer telling me what to do. And I look so awkward and uncomfortable because I'm not a model. I'm just a regular girl, you know? And so it was kind of a funny reel that I've put together to show like, this is what it takes to do an actual photo shoot and to put these pictures together. But here's the real me at the end of the day. You know, I've got pineapple hair 9 times out of 10. I'm not wearing makeup half the time. I work in workout clothes on a regular basis. That's just kind of the real life. And I think that's what people want to start seeing more and more of.
Yeah. I mean, the touched up and retouched, you know, images, you know, we see constantly how, you know, they'll show up on magazines. They're like, and this is what it actually looked like. And, you know, mm-hmm. the person has 4 extra inches on their waistline and, you know, everything else. Like it's amazing. And sad, really, the vanity that's gone into that to portray, and it especially affects women. You know, but how women are portrayed in media. And I think in a lot of ways, social media has done us a disservice. You know, it's funny to think back to when I was a kid and we had a roll of film that, you know, sometimes wouldn't get developed for months and sometimes years.
Yeah.
You know, when I spent 2 years in Chile, I brought home rolls of film. I had a bunch done while I was there. But like it wasn't digital. I mean, this is, you know, pre 2000. So, I mean, everything was on film. Mm-hmm. And it was it's funny because you don't get the same, Instagram couldn't have existed in that world, you know,
yeah.
And now we have it. So we're about out of time for today, Shannon, but I wanted to get just kind of your last thought and word as it comes to personal branding. You know, as what you're doing with 36, you know, how can people get a hold of you in order to, you know, if they are looking for your services, and mm-hmm. two, beyond that, you know, just some easy things maybe that they can do to freshen up or to really get started with that, with their personal branding efforts.
Yeah. So first off, our website is 36mktg.com, or you can follow us on Instagram, which is at 36mktg.com. You can also find me on my own personal Instagram page. That way it's at Shannon_E_Lewis. The biggest thing that I always recommend when people are starting to build that personal brand and they have no idea what they're doing in terms of that is go find other people within your industry that are doing it right. Do not copy them because it's already been done. So what I mean by that is if you go and follow my page and you see what I'm doing, clearly I've already done it. So the same type of following is not going to reciprocate the same way to you as they are to me because they already see these, you know, types of shots or types of captions being done. But what I do recommend is seeing how they're doing it, see the consistency with how they're posting, mirror that. Find what makes you you and mirror that same look and feel, but making it authentic to you personally.
Awesome. You know, that's, yeah. And that same advice can and should be used across a number of different ways, not just when it's talking about personal branding. So, hey, Shannon, thanks so much for joining us again. You guys can find her at Shannon_E_Lewis and that's Lewis with a W on Instagram, or at 36mktg.com on Instagram as well. Shannon, thanks so much for hanging out with me today, and look forward to seeing some of your fun stuff coming forward.
Yes, likewise.
Hey, thanks for listening, and please remember to subscribe and leave feedback. Now, if you'd like some free training for your team, go to podcast.mlmrenegade.com and get your free 21st century recruiting Kickstarter.